Hallo.
Hallo.
Amira Willighagen, zeg ik dat goed?
Ja.
Hoe oud? Amira Willighagen, 9 jaar oud, staat hier.
Ben je echt wel 9?
Ja.
Jeetje.
Amira, ze zeggen wel eens dat oude zielen voortleven in mensen. En als ik jou hoor zingen, dan heb jij...
Thank you.
Friends, we're here today to celebrate the passing of our fellow congregant, Alfin Anton Winn, originally Wininski. Alfin died about a month ago. We had a funeral service for him here. And I've known Alfin for, I would say since about 1970. And I was privileged to actually live with him in Calgary for a period of several months. So let's begin our memorial service and please rise. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. In the name of the I Am that I Am, and by the love of the light which lighteth every man and woman that cometh into the world, we come upon the throne of God, we come to the throne of God to give glory and praise for thy will, thy all-accompanying love, that thy action here below as above, fulfilling the cosmic law and the cosmic purpose within each heart. Our Father in heaven, we pray for the souls who come together this day in heaven and on earth to salute the glory of the risen Christ and our beloved Alfin Winn and all who follow him in the regeneration. May life and love increase in all hearts because thy love is fulfilled in him this day. We pray for all who mourn that they might be comforted. We pray that the Holy Comforter might be that spirit of living truth that defines and redefines individual destiny. And we pray for understanding that we might share and know thy plan for each one. In the name of the Father and of the Mother and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we thank thee, O God, for thy infinite mercy unto all. Alfin had three songs that he especially thought would be good for his memorial service. And the first is Rose of Light. What number is that?
From thy fragrant center light, through thy petals blazing bright, comes God's love intensely pure, rose of light, love will endure.
Number 468.
Rose of light, thy power flows, fiery, silent, majestic rose, through
Now Psalm, please be seated, Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And let us sing Amazing Grace, another of his requests for our song here. Song 75. 55. Thank you. Where it says that when the When our life ceases here on earth, that we'll then possess beyond the veil a life of joy and peace. I had a chance to talk with Alfin for several weeks before he passed on, and I think we were of an equal mind that a little healing joy and peace is a good thing, and after that we can get back to work. It was Jesus who said, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, and if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I am the resurrection and the life. And he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." So let us remember the immortal words of St. Paul. "I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, in the last trump, when the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this incorruptible must put on incorruption. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. And when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? Grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the sting of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." As I think of this great plan, I fall on my knees before the Father, from whom all fatherhood earthly and heavenly derives its name. And I pray that out of the glorious riches of his resources, he will enable you to know the strength of the Spirit's inner reinforcement, that Christ may actually live in your hearts by faith. And I pray that you, rooted and founded in love yourselves, may be able to grasp with Christians how wide and long and deep and high is the love of Christ, and to know for yourselves that love so far above our understanding. So will you be filled through all your being with God himself. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, worlds without end. Amen. You know, many years ago, back in the, I guess it would be the very early 80s, I actually went up to Canada and worked and lived with Alfin for about 3 months. And he was going through a tough time, a divorce and so forth at the time. And the business was difficult. And so I got to know him really well. And one of the things that some of the people who sent letters of witness, the constant theme that they all had is that he was a hard worker. That whatever he did, he put himself to all of it. And that when he did, things worked out. So I guess conscientiousness was probably one of Alfin's biggest virtues, biggest roots of character. We had a lot of fun and some difficult times during those 3 months in Calgary. And one of the things I noticed was that Alfin was an extremely generous fellow. Historically, he's been very generous, a contributor to the church. But during the time that I was up there, I noticed he was generous with the people that he dealt with. He told me that very early on, he was one of his mentors taught him that in negotiations, and he worked himself up, you know, in real estate from having nothing to being a multimillionaire, actually. And then his fortunes went up and down and so forth and so on. But he was a very good businessman. And the fellow told him, and he said it was always a core of his dealing with other people. He said, always leave the other man enough room to breathe. And, you know, at one level, that sounds like it doesn't have to be generous. It could be sort of like minimalist. But what was meaning there is that both people should be able to walk away upright. And so he always had that in his mind when he was trying to work something out. I remember one time during that time, it was right after the class that we had called the Class of Elohim. So it had dictations from the seven Elohim and also from Surya and Kuzco. And Mother said at that time, and this is back in those days, if you had a big TV, it was a projection unit. You had a big screen, and then you had your projector out here, and there were different ways they put that all together, but they hadn't really come up with, you know, big screens that were kind of self-sufficient yet. So Mother said, if you projected the dictations, the videos of the dictations on a big screen, that it would help to anchor Elohim for you and your city. And so we all thought that was a really lovely idea, but at that time, those kinds of projectors were pretty expensive, about $3,000, and that was, I don't know how much $3,000 is in today's money, because we have two things going on. You need more money to get what you got, but also the cost of our digital equipment and so forth is also coming down per unit, so we'll see how all that works out. But it was a very, very generous thing. He just said, well, we'll get the thing, you know, and he made arrangements so that we could have that. And he was always like that. If something needed to be done, then it was pretty much like that. Now, here in the teaching center, or here at St. Mark's, Mary Lou Miller actually spent a great deal of time working with Alfin. A legal representative, right? A legal representative. Because Alfin had actually been sick for about 20 years, maybe even a little longer, and he was in a great deal of pain. He'd had some kind of a mechanical incident when he was working. Now, he grew up on a farm, And so they raised crops and they had dairy and so forth. And when he started out, he'd oftentimes be on a farm implement that was drawn by two horses. Okay, so he was a hardworking farmer from the very beginning. And Alfin was the youngest of five boys, and there were seven sisters. So the family were 11 kids, all working on the farm. He was born in 1938 in Saskatchewan. Mom and Dad were Leon and Mary Wininski. At this time, he's about 84 when he died, and he survived by one brother who's in a nursing home, and then by the sister Louise who's retired in Florida, and of course by his son, Ty Wynn, and Ty's family in Calgary. So they were in a rural area, and they had a small schoolhouse, and three of the kids, including the next door farm neighbor, son who was about his same age, named Tom, I met him also when I was up there, and they went to school together and played together and grew up together. One of the things that was interesting is that Alfin was the first Canadian distributor of motivational tapes, especially Ron, R-O-H-N. And so he was always interested in the blending of the practical and the spiritual or the aspirational and so forth. How does the inner world and the outer world connect together? In 1970, he married Joyce Lowry, and they soon adopted a son, a beautiful young towhead. In fact, that's a word I always wondered about when I was growing up, because my sister and I were towheads, but I couldn't figure out what a toe, I thought of my big toe, and I couldn't figure out what a towhead was. Well, it turns out that toe is another word for flax, and flax in the field is light golden color. So the towheads are those children who have kind of platinum blonde, almost white hair, but it always changes color over time, almost always, a few rare exceptions. So in the same way that most blondes get darker, the towheads also do, and they can even, like Ty did, end up with very dark hair. He's a fine looking young man, and now thrives with his own family in Calgary. Then in 1995, Alfin married Barbara Smith in Oroville, California, and they lived in Virginia. All in all, he was here in the Montana area for about 37 years. Belgrade, South Glastonbury, Billings. And one year, it seems to me that was in the early 80s, wasn't it, when he went on the, in the All-Montana Stump, which he invented by himself, and put together with his car. His car was plastered with all sorts of posters and pictures and sayings, you know, bumper stickers and things, all of which were proclaiming freedom for America and freedom for the light bearers of the world. And so he took several months and he traveled all over Montana, distributing also posters for the July class that year. So when he got an idea in his head, he kind of went for it. And he had his favorite little poster on there was in, I think it said in the back window here, and it said, "God is my co-pilot." So he very much had a sense that he wasn't on a purely solo mission. Mary Lou, would you like to say a couple of things?
Thank you all for coming. Alfin is here. I feel his presence, and he's very joyful. So I want you to know that he first came to the Cinnabar store when I was working there. And he lived here in Livingston at that time on Thelma Compton's, one of her houses. And so he wanted to move to Glastonbury. He bought some property down there. And so he went, I shouldn't say he went, Mother asked Robert Edgley, my husband at that time, if he would move a mobile home in for on his land. So Robert did that. So whenever Alfin saw me, he just would always say, "This is..." I mean, even when we were here in Livingston together and he was coming to St. Mark's, "Oh," he says, "I just love you and Robert." He says, "If it wasn't for you, I probably wouldn't have been living in South Glastonbury. But, you know, we were both working there and you do things for each other. That's what we're here for." And Robert was happy to do that. And it's a big job moving one of those trailers into that side of the hills. but Alfin grew beautiful gardens. He loved to farm. He always called himself a farmer, even though it was just a small acreage. But you see on the slideshow here that there's a picture of him in a garden. He just felt the earth, and he felt God in every handful of dirt he ever had in his hand. He helped people down there with moving land. What I'm saying is he pushed a lot of soil around. He hauled a lot of things for people, and he was very grateful to do that. He was the server. He loved to serve, and he loved, I can't tell you how many times we've been together that he's told me how much he loved the teachings and the masters, and especially Mother, because he felt close to her, and he told me several lifetimes that they were together, and he just was willing to share that beautiful story of love, the masters, serving. And I don't know any too many people that he ever said that he didn't get along with. So I'm grateful for the opportunity of having to help serve for Alfin, because it was a lot of years. I mean, I think 2002 I became his power of attorney, and there until about 2 years ago, we were almost attached at the hip. So he was so grateful when he finally came back to Livingston. He lived in Billings, and he was there in three different times, I think three different apartments that I know of, because he always said, I gotta move, I don't have anybody to help me move. And I says, well, I'll bring my family. And so my family went, and we helped move him three times. And then it was when he was here at Frontier Assisted Living in Livingston that he was really happy to be in Livingston, because he could come to church. And so without fail, if he was feeling well, he came to St. Mark's and worshiped with us. And he loved the fellowship that we have with our meals when we share on Sundays. But I want you to know that I loved him as a Chila on the path. He was definitely a Chila all the way. And even when in the end times when he was not feeling well, through all of this pain and suffering that he was going through with his physical body, he would take his books and read them. And he couldn't do a lot of singing or decreeing in where he had his room at Frontier, but he loved to read. When he came here, he could let the billows out, just shout and be with all of us. But I want Alfin's memory to be that he was a definite Chila of the Ascended Masters, and that I had the opportunity of talking with Louise and his sister that's in Florida, and Troy, several times, both of them. And they're lovely, lovely people, and very kind. And I was hoping that they could watch it today, and I'm glad that we had it on so they can watch it. And God bless Alfin, wherever you are. I feel your presence here, and we want you to know we miss you and we love you. Thank you.
A few people who couldn't be here sent a note, and Dr. Gammon used to be a member of the community here, and he in a letter that he wrote, he said, Alfin is one of the rare people that one meets in life who really cares for others. He's honest. His integrity is without blemish. I've known him to be a very hard worker, extremely dependable. He would be an asset to anything he endeavored to become involved with. He's the kind of person who does that little extra and gives all to his work to produce superior products. I've seen Alfin strive many times to put out the extra effort required to do the best job possible. I must also note the loyalty that I have seen Alfin display in dealing with friends and acquaintances. It's a very admirable quality, especially in this day and age. And then there's more, but that's the extract from it. And then he worked when he was in Belgrade, he worked at Dad's IGNA, and the owner there said that Alfin was an extraordinarily sincere in his desire to do a good job, and that he would go to great lengths to make sure that all areas of responsibilities were taken care of, and anything that he saw, he would simply go for it. So he was always looking out for the best for our business. And then there were other people also that he worked with who said that that he took care of things they didn't even know were wrong and saved their bacon. And this sort of thing happened a few times. And then many of you remember Dr. Kurtz. And he says, I've known Alfin as a friend since 1994. And I followed him through the years and found him to be so cooperative. He has such an excellent mind. I've observed him at work, extraordinarily conscientious. And when he sets out to do something, it's done. It's without reservation that I recommend him for anything he wants to do. So these are the kinds of responses that we get. And I think especially of Kathy Ryler in Belgrade, a real estate agent that he also knew. And he said, Alfin Winn is probably one of the nicest, good-hearted people that I've met. On numerous occasions, Mr. Winn was kindly volunteered to help my mom, who's a resident of the apartment he lives in, by bringing her groceries and helping out when needed. He's a model neighbor. He doesn't bother anyone, doesn't infringe on anyone's space, and is respectful of others. He's the friendliest, most giving person in the whole apartment building that I've witnessed. He's a kind Christian man whose heart is definitely in the right place, and some people could take lessons from him. Alfin is a very gracious man, a gentle human being. If people put as much time and effort into helping others like Mr. Winn does, this would definitely be a better place. I even think that there wouldn't be war today if we had more people like him caring for others in the world. Now, you know, when you live close with someone who's in a lot of pain and has had problems, and Alfin was subject to medical and sometimes mental medical problems, then it's difficult to sometimes take the larger perspective and to see how this plays into the great picture of God's plan, of the individual striving with the limitations, and we all have our limitations. And yet how other people, such as we've heard here, can see him only in the finest light. So I think that oftentimes in our spiritual trek with our brothers and sisters, we have opportunities that are brought to us by friends like Alfin, and it teaches us, among other things, how to love better. He always worked hard. He always was conscientious of other people. He always was looking for the needs of the others, and yet he was in great pain, and that oftentimes brought him back to self-care. So this kind of being able to go in and out from the needs of the self and the needs of others, if you happen to come in when it's on an out pattern, it looks extraordinarily generous. If you come in when it's an in pattern, you say, I don't know if I can stand the pain myself. So we learn to expand our mind and to expand our heart with our friends who are with us on the path. And if they're here, and as the Bible says, unless they're a hypocrite, they're here. And Alfin may have been any number of things, but a hypocrite he was not. He was sincere. He was loving. And he so much loved Mother and the Masters. This I saw when I lived with him, because he put it into his day. He thought that the decreeing was very important. I wanted to share with you an excerpt from a letter that Mother wrote. And she says, "Thanks so much for your letter and gift to us for Christmas. We'll be donating it to the church for a program we're working on." And then she says, "You asked me to teach you how to love Mother Mary as your father Lanello so sweetly loved her. I believe the Crystal Rosary of Kuan Yin, as we give it now twice a month on the first and the third Sundays, and is the means to the melting of all hardness of heart and all fear of God the Father or fear of God the Mother in the negative sense of fear. I also believe that talking to Mother Mary, believing she's with you, speaking to her as you give her rosary and sing her songs, simply holding a perpetual communion with her Immaculate Heart, will so open you to her heart that you will not be able to do anything else but love her. And of course, Saint Germain's heart meditations are designed to increase the threefold flame and purge all misuses of the heart chakra by the violet flame. God bless you, Alfin. Keep on keeping on. You are making progress on the path. Do not be discouraged. My love is always with you." You know, in the last few weeks, when I would visit Alfin in Billings at his retirement home, at his assisted living home, he had decorated his room with a number of pictures of the Masters and things that meant something to him, and I was especially touched by a series of photographs that he had of his son Tai, which was placed on a wall where he would look at that a few times during the day. And he had such a great love for Tai. Now, the marriage ended in a divorce, and that hit Alfin very hard. And he kind of figured he fought for a while, and then he kind of gave up, and he said, "Well, it's over, and I've lost my wife and my son." Now, it may not have actually needed to be that way, but that was how he took it. And so, even though there wasn't continued communication with Tai, he always had his picture, and he would stop occasionally and look at that picture, and you could see the love that would flow out of him to Tai through that picture. So it's one of those extraordinary and strange cases where there's a great deal of love and somehow it doesn't quite get through on the physical plane because there's a perceived barrier or break. And yet there's actually a great deal of love and a daily exercise of sending love. So I hope that Tai has that understanding that his father was not as good as a communicator as he was a loving father. He did love him very much. I was able to observe this. And yet the external communication was not clear and easy and free as it should have been, as it could have been. So I know that this is one of those circumstances of life that can be healed and that can be healing to know about. And so I'm sure, Alfin, that you're pleased to have me share this bit of information. And Tai, I hope that you're able to receive it and to understand that your father loved you. And what's the next song?
How Great Thou Art.
How Great Thou Art. This is the third song that Alfin wanted to have played at the at his memorial service.
73.
And it's song 73 in the songbook.
Please stand. Let's let the bellows out.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. My soul, my Savior, unto thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sing my soul, my Savior, unto thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Seated, and let us listen to Mark Prophet. It is finished.
It is finished. Done with this episode in strife. I am made one with immortal life. Calmly, I am resurrecting my spiritual energies from the great treasure house of immortal knowing. the days I knew with thee, O Father, before the world was, the days of triumph when all of the thoughts of thy being soared over the ageless hills of cosmic memory. Come again as I meditate upon thee, each day as I call forth thy memories from the scroll of immortal life. I am thrilled anew. Patterns wondrous to behold enthrall me with the wisdom of thy creative scheme. So fearfully and wonderfully am I made that none can mar thy design. None can despoil the beauty of thy holiness. None can discourage the beating of my heart in almost wild anticipation of thy fullness made manifest in me. O great and glorious Father, how shall a tiny bird created in hierarchical bliss elude thy compassionate attention? I am of greater value than many birds, and therefore do I know that thy loving thoughts reach out to me each day to console me in seeming aloneness, to raise my courage, elevate my concepts, exalt my character, flood my being with virtue and power, sustain thy cup of life flowing over within me, and abide within me forever in the nearness of thy heavenly presence. I cannot fail because I am thyself in action everywhere. I ride with thee upon the mantle of the clouds. I walk with thee upon the waves and crests of waters abundant. I move with thee in the undulations of thy currents, passing over the thousands of hills composing earth's crust. I am alive with thee in each bush, flower and blade of grass. All nature sings in thee and me, for we are one. I am alive in the hearts of the downtrodden, raising them up. I am the law exacting the truth of being in the hearts of the proud, debasing the human creation therein and spurring the search for thy reality. I am all things of bliss, to all people of peace. I am the full facility of divine grace, the spirit of holiness, releasing all hearts from bondage into unity. It is finished. Thy perfect creation is within me. Immortally lovely, it cannot be denied the blessedness of being. Like unto thyself, it abides in the house of reality, never more to go out into profanity. It knows only the wonders of purity and victory. Yet there stirs within this immortal fire a consummate pattern of mercy and compassion, seeking to save forever that which is lost, wandering away from the beauty of reality and truth. I am the living Christ in action evermore. It is finished. Death and human concepts have no power in my world. I am sealed by God's design with the fullness of that Christ love that overcomes, transcends, and frees the world by the power of the three times three. Until all the world is God victorious, ascended in the light and free. It is finished. Completeness is the allness of God. Day unto day, an increase of strength, devotion, life, beauty, and holiness occurs within me. Released from the fairest flower of my being, the Christ consecrated rose of Sharon, unfolding its petals within my heart. My heart is the heart of God. My heart is the heart of the world. My heart is the heart of Christ. In whom I am. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end, when with the voice of immortal love, I too shall say, it is finished.
May the blessing and benediction of Almighty God be upon this company, upon the soul of Alfin Winn, and upon his family and friends. With the sign of the heart, the head, and the hand to you, may the peace of the presence abide with you. Wherever you are, wherever you go, may the glorious peace of your presence flow. Through days of service and nights of rest, may the peace of the presence keep you blessed. With the sign of the heart, the head, and the hand to you, may the six-pointed star and the cross of white fire from the heart of Jesus and Gautama watch between thee and me while we are absent one from another and present with our God. Amen. Thank you. So we are all of us approaching the milestones of our lives, one of them which will be a transition. I suppose there might be those who, like Enoch, walked with God and was not, and so forth. And I know that we can all of us walk with God, and that will come a time when we are not here in embodiment as we've known it. But we will be where we shall be. And the goodness and the grace of the presence shall continue to accomplish its perfect work and its progress on the path. Thank you for joining me in my little journey and progress on the path. I'm happy to be here with you. And God bless us while we're here. Bye.
When you come to the end of a perfect day and you sit alone with your thought, while the chimes ring out with a carol gay for the joy that the day has brought, do you think that the end of a perfect day it means to a tired heart? When the sun goes down with a flaming ray and the dear friends have to part, for memory has painted this perfect day with colors that never fade, and we find at the end of a perfect day the soul of
gentlemen, Keith Potker, Bruce Woodley, Ethel Guy, Judith Durham, The Seekers, singing I Am Australian.